It's a real honour to be here. It's lovely to be able to speak to you. And I want to talk to you a little bit about my story and how it came about and why I wrote it the way I wrote it. The Valley of Lost Secrets is my first book and it came out in January this year. So I'm very new to being an author, but I'm absolutely loving it. And one of the nicest things is to get to do things like this. So even though I'm not in the room with you, I still get to talk to you and hear your questions, which is actually my favourite bit of all. So I'll tell you a little bit about it. It's set in 1939, in September, at the very, very beginning of the Second World War, when lots of children were evacuated from places that were thought to be dangerous into places that were thought to be safe. And mostly, that's what happened. Evacuees had different sorts of experiences. Some had really nice experiences and some had not so nice experiences. So my children in my story, who I will talk to you a little bit more about in a minute individually, they are evacuated from Islington in London to a fictional place called Llanbryn in South Wales. And I chose Islington because I used to live there a long time ago, and I still go back a lot and have friends there, and I love it. So I wanted my characters to come from that place. And I think it helps sometimes to write about places that you feel something for, even if you're completely making them up, even if you're writing fantasy, because that helps you to enjoy what you're doing. So my main character is called Jimmy, and he's evacuated with his little brother called Ronnie to this place called Llanbryn. And once they're there, Jimmy, first of all, makes a very shocking discovery, and he discovers a human skull hidden in the hollow of a tree. And that's something that changes Jimmy's life for the better. And you wouldn't think it would be, would you? You wouldn't think that finding a skull in a hollow tree, which is a really scary thing, would be something that would make someone's life better, but it does for Jimmy. And not just for him, for everyone else around him too, the people in the village they've gone to, and his brother and his new friend, who's the girl on the front there, who I'll again tell you a little bit more about in a second, because characters are really, really important to me. When I write my stories, it's character first. When I'm reading, I'm the same. I have to feel something for the characters, otherwise there's no point. If I don't care what happens to them, then I'm not really interested in getting to the end of a book. So it's all about character for me. And you can see again from the cover, which is by an illustrator called David Dean, who I'm really pleased has done a wonderful job. And you can see in the bottom corner there, there's a mine with smoke blowing out of it. So even though lots of Wales is beautiful, and I think that all sorts of different things can be beautiful, people usually expect lovely beaches like down on the Gower Coast, the Gower Peninsula, or they expect, lovely mountains like Snowdonia. And we have all those things, but we also have a lot of industry. And in those days, in 1939, we had more industry. And I'm from a steel town. I'm from a town called Port Talbot. So I'm from a place with a lot of industry and smoke in the air, but it's still beautiful and the mountains are beautiful. And I wanted to show that. And I was really pleased that that was shown on the cover, and those type of houses, those terraced houses. I grew up in a house really similar to that. So I'm bringing myself to this story. So if I could have the next slide, please, and I can talk to you about how it began. So I never thought I'd write historical fiction. I did a course at a university called Bath Spa called a master's, and a master's is something you can do after you've done a degree, and it was in writing for young people. And one of the tasks we were asked to do at the very beginning of the course was to write something historical, just about 1,200 words, which is about four sides of A4 typed up, not a great deal. And I thought, well, I'll have a go. I think it's about getting out of your comfort zone sometimes, because as I say, I didn't think I'd write historical, and here I am currently writing my third book, and they're all set in the past. So it's interesting what you can do when you try something new. So I thought to myself, what can I write about? What era can I set these 1,200 words in, not knowing that they would become a whole book? And I remembered this article. So some of you are probably reading it already. And this is a true story that I came across when I was researching another story which didn't become a book at all. And when I look back now, I can see why, because my writing's much better now than it was then. And it's that thing, isn't it? Practice makes you get better. So I stuck at it. And I remembered this story and I found it interesting. And I'd printed it off and put it in a box that I keep on or near my desk, depending how tidy I'm feeling, which isn't always very tidy, to be honest. And I dug it out and I thought, well, this takes place in real life, in history. This took place in 1943. So I could use that. And I was a primary school teacher for a long time. And my favourite era of history to teach was World War II. So I thought, again, it's only 1,200 words. I'll write set it then. So the true story, a human skull and consequently bones were found inside a hollow tree. But this was in Hagley in the West Midlands of England. So, and that mystery has not been solved to this day. They still don't know who was in the tree. They know it was a woman. And that's why in this particular article, which is a few years old now, they thought it might have been this woman called Bella. And there were all sorts of rumours about it. And it became almost a kind of, almost like a mythical type of thing. There was graffiti daubed on buildings around the area, who put Bella in the witch elm. So I took that idea, just that spark of an idea, and made it into my own mystery, because that's what you can do when you're writing. You can take something and completely make it what you want it to be, and that's brilliant. So I decided to put it in South Wales, because that's where I'm from, changed the date a bit. I played around with the year a lot, trying to decide exactly when I was going to set it. And I didn't really know it until I was very far into drafting it. And I decided that my main character would be a boy called Jimmy. And I decided to write from his point of view. And I just sat down to do it. And Jimmy and Ronnie appeared and they felt instantly real to me. And I loved them and I wanted to keep writing about them. And the people on my course with me and my tutor said, this is the one that you need to try and make become a book. So that's how that came about. It was really a case of, as I say, getting out of my comfort zone and trying something new. So I took it to South Wales, created a mystery that could be solved. And that's sort of how it went from inspiration to actual book. So if I could have the next slide, please. So there's Jimmy, and he's 12 and he really, really didn't want to be evacuated. He misses his dad back in London. He misses his nan. Ronnie, who you can see there in the red jumper, he's only six. So the 6-year age gap is really big when you're that age. So Jimmy feels very much that Ronnie is his little brother and he's responsible for him. And Jimmy sort of doesn't like it, but he needs it, because there's something he says at the very beginning. They get off the train and they go to the Miners Institute to be chosen by people who are going to take them in as evacuees. And Ronnie's worried and frightened and he's crying. And Jimmy says something like, it's okay for him to cry, but I can't cry because I'm the big brother and I'm 12, which of course we know 12-year-old boys, of course you can cry. But Jimmy feels that he's got to be strong for Ronnie. And it actually is quite good for Jimmy to have that responsibility, because it gives him someone to focus on while he is actually just as scared himself, because everything's new. He's gone from a city to the countryside, but a Welsh industrial sort of countryside. So I describe it in the book as a different type of countryside. And he's confused and he doesn't know why there's a mine and smoke and big black things on the mountain which look like sand dunes, but they're black. And later on he finds out it's to do with a coal mine, and so he's scared as well. And then there is Ronnie. He is someone that everybody thinks Ronnie's really cute, and I think he's really cute, and he is. He's sweet and he's cute and he's very accepting of the situation. They're taken in by a lovely couple called Mr. and Mrs. Thomas, Alan and Gwen, and straight away Ronnie is very receptive of their love and care. He loves being looked after. Jimmy is very resistant of it. He won't accept it. He's quite rude, to be honest, at first. Sometimes he's very he just pushes them away all the time, and they're so patient with him. And even when he sort of wants to be happy with the lovely food, because Mrs. Thomas is a great cook, and there's things he starts to like, he won't let himself really like them, because he's thinking he sort of thinks he's somehow betraying his family, and he doesn't want to be like that. Things change throughout the story, as you can imagine. And then we have Florence. Florence is very special. A lot of people tell me that she's their favourite character. She is feisty. I know that's a word that gets used a lot, particularly about girl characters, but she is. She comes from a very different home to Jimmy and Ronnie. They're all very working class children, because again, that's me. I'm a working class person. It's really important to me to show that in my stories. But Jimmy and Ronnie came from a nice family that looked after them. Florence didn't. Florence had a horrible time, and Florence is dirty and smelly when she gets to Llanbryn, but she's taken in by a lovely woman called Phyllis, who runs the local shop, and she's got a son called Ian. And straight away Florence blossoms. She's cleaned up. She gets that ribbon you can see in her hair there, which was so important to me. I said, please can Florence have her blue ribbon on the cover? And it was a bit emotional when I saw it, because she, as I say, she blossoms. And her and Jimmy are not friends at all when they're in London. They really don't like each other, and they have a horrible argument at the beginning of the book. But then things change and they become a team. And I really enjoyed writing the changes in those relationships. They tell each other secrets and they learn to trust each other. So nearly at the end of what I'm going to say. So that's a bit about the story, how it came about, the main characters, and where I've set it. So this is just a quick little sneak peek at my next book, which is out in January. So I'm not going to talk much about that now. You can ask me questions, obviously, if you want to, but it's called When the War Came Home. And the war in this case is the First World War, and it's set just afterwards, and it's about the aftermath of boys who lied about their age and went to fight too young, and about the girl you can see running up the mountain with her arm up. That's Natty. And so this time I've written from the point of view of a girl, which has been interesting after Jimmy. And that's as I say, that's out in January. So that's my next book. And you can probably tell that we have the same illustrator for that. And again, we've got a very Welsh feel, but this time there's not a mine in the background, there's a factory. So that's what I've been up to so far. And as I say, at the moment I'm writing the third one, which is set in a different time again and hasn't got anything to do with the war. So so that's the end of the slideshow presentation. So if anyone's got any questions, then I'd love to hear them. Ask away. Lily. Hi, Lily. Right. So I love it. It's great. It's been a little bit, it's been a lot different to what I thought it would be, because my book came out in January and all the shops were shut. So I didn't actually get to see it in a shop till April. And it was the book of the month at Waterstones. And that's meant to be a really big thing where you go around lots of shops and see it on tables. And I couldn't do any of that. So that was a bit sad, but I made the most of it. And hopefully it'd be a little bit different next year. It's really nice to just look at a book and think, I wrote it. I I still now sometimes look at the cover and I see my name on it and it says Lesley Parr. And I think that's a different Lesley Parr. That's not me. It can't be. I sort of feel totally attached to it and slightly removed from it at the same time because I wanted it for so long. I started seriously wanting to be an author, changing my life around it almost 11 years ago. So it took me 10 years to get to this point.
How did I think of the name of the book? Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And who's that? What's your name?
Hugo.
Hugo. Yes. Did I get that right? Yay! Yes. That's such a brilliant name. Hugo. It took a long time, and it was the only time where I kind of freaked out and went, it's going to have a horrible title and I'm going to hate it and what's going to happen, because it had lots of titles. So as I was writing it, I just called it the Witch Elm, which is the type of tree that Jimmy finds the skull in. And I knew it was never going to be the real title. And then it became Echo Through the Valley. And then when it went out to publishers to try to get a book deal, it was called Hollow, after the hollow in the tree. And I loved it and I wanted it to be called that. But my publisher said, it's going to sound a bit too spooky. So we did lots of work and lots of brainstorming, and I had big sheets of paper and different pens, and my agent helped as well. And we focused in on the keywords we wanted. They wanted secrets, I wanted valley. And I came up with that. And to be honest, I'm really happy because if it didn't have that title, if it was called Hollow, it wouldn't have that cover. I think the cover just fits in with the title. So yeah, I'm not chapter titles. I always name my chapters. Chapter titles come to me very easily. Book titles, not so much. Hi, Jacob. That's a really good question. As I was researching this other story, which I said wasn't brilliant and didn't become a book, I was actually researching trees, and I was looking for types of trees that would grow next to a river. And this story popped up on my internet search, and I thought, oh, that's interesting, and I'll keep that and I'll tuck it away, as I said. And, you know, lo and behold, I needed it in the future. And that's something you can do. I sometimes hear things and I'll write them down, or I read something interesting, I scribble it down or I print it out and I keep it in that ideas box. And sometimes when I need to come up with ideas, I'll like rummage through it. Other times with my second book, again, it was through research. I thought my book was going to be one thing and it became very different. I'm sure in school you write a lot. When you're writing stories, you sometimes write different drafts of it. It's not, you know, it's not going to be right first time. So, and it's certainly no different for published authors. So with that one, I thought it was going to be about women's rights after the First World War and women having to come out of the factories and go back into sort of domestic work and that. But it turned into being about soldiers. It's still about rights, but now it's about workers' rights. And it just evolved. Things change as you get into them and you find your way through a story. My third one was slightly different. Again, it was a feeling. It was a feeling of wanting to create a certain kind of story, and I built it around that. But research often turns up things unexpectedly. Okay, so I did it really gradually. I stopped being a full-time class teacher at the end of 2010, because I just felt like I wanted something new in my life. So I started to do some evening classes locally and read more around, you know, get involved with the children's book world as well. And it was a gradual thing. So up until the pandemic, I've still been teaching. I've been doing supply teaching. So just at one school, just one primary school that I've been going back and forth to for about 8 years, and I'd still be doing that now if it wasn't so difficult. So I kept my connection with children, and that's really important to me because I absolutely loved being a teacher. And being an author now, I can sort of marry two things I love, which is being with, not so much because a lot of my stuff's been done on video lately, but I can marry together that love of writing and reading, which I always love teaching and doing with the children as well, and actually being with children. So it's like the best of both worlds, really. And I probably will do some teaching again, yeah, when things settle down. It wasn't a difficult transition because it was a slow one. It wasn't my idea. It was my editor. When you, something the children might not really realise, but when you're an author, you know, you're not writing it completely on your own. You have someone called an editor at your publishing house who helps you. And mine's a wonderful woman called Zoe Griffiths. And she's the one who sort of, you know, gave me my book deal with Bloomsbury. And your editor helps you to write it. It's sort of like your teacher does in a way, supports you, gives you tips, or what if you change that? And it was Zoe's idea to have, I won't give any spoilers either, but if you look at there's an illustration around at the beginning of every chapter. Hang on. I'm not very good at holding it up to the camera, am I? It's a bit of glare on it. Let me just turn my lamp off, see if that makes a difference. It doesn't really, does it? Anyway, there's a tree there, and let's just say the illustration doesn't stay the same and it follows a pattern of what's going on in the actual story. But it was Zoe's idea to have that, just to have that bit of difference in my story. And like you just said, people love it. People love that looking, and I would have loved it when I was a child, just like looking for, oh, has it changed, and that sort of thing. It came from Zoe. Thanks. Bye.